all of our guests to take their seats. The Joint Subcommittees on Commerce, Manufacturing, and Trade and the Subcommittee on Communications and Technology will now come to order. I'll recognize myself 4 minutes for the purpose of an opening statement. And I do want to welcome you all to our joint hearing on the transatlantic data flows and the impact of the European Union Safe Harbor decision. Over 4,400 businesses have self-certified compliance with the Safe Harbor Agreement through the Department of Commerce. A lot of jobs, a lot of industries are connected to those 4,400 businesses. The Safe Harbor Agreement has provided a mechanism to carry out commerce with the European Union. There is no trade partnership that is more important than the trade partnership with the European Union. The depth and breadth of the United States and the European Union relationship is not simply economic, it is strategically important, and it's also one of respect and cooperation. In today's world, as our members know, you can't do business without digital data flows. So today, our two subcommittees send an important message. There is no reason to delay. Both sides have all that is needed to put a sustainable safe harbor agreement into place. It is our understanding that there is an agreement in principle, and I certainly thank the important work that the Department of Commerce has done to achieve a new agreement. They offered a bipartisan briefing to our members. Their message was the correct one. We cannot let anything get in the way of moving as quickly as possible to secure the new safe harbor agreement. I also want to thank the important enforcement work that the Federal Trade Commission has done enforcing the existing safe harbor framework. I know that they will continue to do the same for the new safe harbor. For the sake of our jobs, for the sake of small and medium-sized businesses relying on the safe harbor and of all of the jobs that they support in both the United States and the European Union, I encourage all parties to stay at the negotiating table to solidify a new data transfer agreement well in advance of the January 2016 deadline. There is no other path forward. And I can assure you that our committee will continue to watch the negotiations closely and to be helpful where we can. I would now like to recognize the Vice Chair of the Telecommunications Subcommittee, Mr. Latta, for the remainder of the time.
Well, I thank the Chairman for yielding, and I also thank our witnesses for being here today. We are all aware of the crucial role the Internet plays in the trade relationship between the United States and the European Union. For over a decade, the U.S.-EU Safe Harbor Agreement has recognized the Internet's importance and kept cross-border data flows open to reduce barriers to trade. However, since the Court of Justice of the EU ruled the agreement invalid, the U.S. has diligently worked on revising the framework to prevent a hindrance to the global economy. My hope for today's hearing is to continue the discussion on a framework that will provide marketplace stability and adequately protect consumer data. It is imperative for U.S. and European companies to be able to operate and conduct transatlantic business with certainty. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back the balance of my time.
Chair, thanks. The gentleman. The gentleman yields back. The chair recognizes the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Commerce, Manufacturing, and Trade, Ms. Schakowsky, for 4 minutes for an opening statement, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Chairman Wyden as well, for calling today's joint hearing on the implications of the SREMS versus Data Collection Commissioner decision on the Safe Harbor Agreement and the future of U.S.-EU cross-border data flows. This is an important and timely subject for our subcommittee to consider, and I welcome our witnesses. The Safe Harbor Framework included principles that U.S. companies could follow in order to meet EU standards for data security and privacy. That framework has enabled American companies to attract and retain European business, with the American and UE economies representing almost half of the global economic activity. The value of a functional safe harbor agreement cannot be overstated. The SREMS decision threatens to undermine business between our countries and the European continent. The more than 4,000 American companies and millions of U.S. employees who have worked to abide by the Safe Harbor Agreement cannot afford that outcome. But the SREM decision does rightly call into question the adequacy of U.S. data security practices. There are legitimate concerns about the protection of personal information collected and stored online, not just for European citizens, but actually for our own as well. As a former member of the House Intelligence Committee, I believe that we must establish adequate and transparent data security and privacy protections. And if we fail to do that, the economic implications could be disastrous. I will soon introduce legislation that would require strong security standards for a wide array of personal data, including geolocation, health-related, biometric, and email and social media account information. It would also require breached companies to report the breach to consumers within 30 days. My bill would enhance data security standards here at home, and it would probably have the added benefit of making the EU more confident in U.S. privacy and data security standards. I look forward to hearing our witnesses' prescriptions for a path forward that will maintain cross-border data flows while enhancing the security of data held in the United States. Our businesses, our workers, and consumers in the United States and European Union deserve no less. And I'd like to yield the balance of my time to Representative Matsui for her remarks.
Thank you very much. Data is a lifeblood of the 21st century economy and critical to innovation and competition. Through my work as co-chair of the Congressional High-Tech Caucus, I understand the importance of cross-border flow policies that support economic growth. This is about more than the over 4,000 businesses which rely on safe harbor, but also the hundreds of millions of consumers in the United States and Europe that rely upon services that move data across borders. We can all agree that the safe harbor standards written before the advent of the smartphone or the widespread use of cloud services deserve to be updated, and we can do so in a way that recognizes the importance of protecting private, personal information while also reaping the benefits of our interconnected economies. I look forward to hearing from today's witnesses, and I yield back the balance of my time.
And I yield back.
Chair, thanks to the gentlelady. Gentlelady yields back. The chair now recognizes the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Upton. 4 minutes for an opening statement, please.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our partnership with Europe has always been marked by friendship, shared interest, and mutual benefit. From autos to ideas, an awful lot of things made in Michigan and across the country have made their way across the Atlantic. Of course, just not the U.S. that benefits from our relationship with Europe. The exchange of goods and services between the U.S. and EU amounts to almost $700 billion. It is critical to both of our economies. Important to this trade infrastructure is the free flow of information, and the inability to pass data freely between the two jurisdictions is a barrier to the growth of our two economies. So we must move swiftly towards a framework for a sustainable safe harbor. And while I recognize there are some who want to leverage this important relationship and focus on areas of disagreement, I would urge folks to keep in mind the countless small and medium enterprises that rely on the safe harbor framework. I support the work and direction of the Department of Commerce in negotiating this new framework, and I encourage its speedy adoption and yield the balance of my time to Ms. Blackburn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I am so appreciative of our witnesses being here and for the hearing on this issue today. It is something that needs some thoughtful attention, and we look forward to directing our attention to solving the issue. The chairman mentioned the amount of trade, and when you're looking at nearly $1 trillion in bilateral trade, and knowing that the free flow of information is important to this, data transfer rights are important to this discussion. We do need to approach this thoughtfully. Mr. Meltzer, I was caught by your stat on digital trade and what it has done to increase U.S. GDP, and then on the fact that the U.S.-EU data transfers are 50% higher than the U.S.-Asia transfers, and I think that those flows, the difference in those flows is really quite remarkable. So I'll want to visit with you more about that. Congress has attempted, through a couple of pieces of legislation, as you all know, the Judicial Redress Act and the Freedom Act, to address the privacy concerns. I had the opportunity several months ago to be in Europe and discuss with some of our colleagues members of parliament, their concerns, and I hope that we're going to be able to negotiate in good faith and find some answers. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I will yield to you the balance of my time if any other member would like to claim it.
Chair, thanks, gentlelady. The gentlelady yields back. The chair recognizes the gentlelady from California, Ms. Eschew, the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Communications.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you and the ranking member of your subcommittee for joining with Communications and Technology Subcommittee to have this important hearing. I thank the witnesses for being here, and we have a very full hearing room. So there's not only a great deal of interest in this issue, but there's a lot at stake. In my Silicon Valley congressional district and on both sides of the Atlantic, companies continue to reel from the October 6th decision by the European Court of Justice to nullify the US-EU Safe Harbor Agreement. As one expert remarked, quote, aside from taking an axe to the undersea fiber optic cables connecting Europe to the United States, it's hard to imagine a more disruptive action to the transatlantic digital commerce. For the past 15 years, thousands of companies, has been stated by I think every member that has spoken so far, both small and large, have relied upon this agreement to effectively and efficiently transfer data across the Atlantic and in a manner that protected consumer privacy. Recognizing the magnitude of the court's decision, earlier this month I joined with several colleagues, both sides of the aisle, in a letter to Secretary Pritzker and the FTC Chairwoman Ramirez, urging the administration to redouble their efforts to come up with a new agreement with the EU. Given the strong economic relationship between the U.S. and EU, estimated over $1 trillion annually. $1 trillion. I mean, you're really talking about something when you say $1 trillion. We have to move quickly with with the European regulators to provide a swift solution to what is no doubt creating a great deal of uncertainty. In practice, this means reaching a Safe Harbor 2.0 agreement as soon as possible. I also think we have to acknowledge that there's an elephant in the room, which is a major contributing factor, in my view, in the court's ruling. Privacy concerns relating to U.S. surveillance methods. Having served on the House Intelligence Committee for nearly a decade, I've consistently worried about the impact of U.S. surveillance activities on both U.S. citizens and companies. Given that the EU's court decision made clear that the U.S. must provide, quote, an adequate level of protection for EU-U.S. data transfers, I look forward to hearing from our witnesses about how this can be achieved in a Safe Harbor 2.0. I think if we don't really deal with this, we'll be missing a large point here. In a digital economy, there's nothing more important than the free flow of data across borders. A Congress that is united in support of this goal and the reinstatement of a new agreement, I think will ensure the continued growth of digital commerce in the years to come. So I thank our witnesses for being here today and for your commitment to ensuring unfettered data transfers between the U.S. and the EU. And with that, I yield back the balance of my time, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
The gentlelady yields back the chair. Thanks, the gentlelady. The chair recognizes the chairman of the Communications and Technology Subcommittee, Mr. Walden, for 4 minutes for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank our witnesses for being here. This is obviously an issue of great importance to all of us. The borderless nature of the Internet is an important force driving economic success and innovation. For Internet-based companies, the value of free flow of digital data between the EU and the United States is obvious. But analysts have also pointed out that up to 75% of the value added by transnational data flows on the Internet goes to traditional industries, especially via increases in global growth, productivity, and employment. Communications and technology underpin every sector of the global economy, from precision farming to sensor-monitored shipping, from Facebook to McDonald's, from footwear manufacturers to custom furniture makers. These networks are the infrastructure of the 21st century economy, and free flow of information is critical to making that infrastructure work. The free flow of information has especially benefited small and medium-sized companies by opening markets on both sides of the Atlantic that were previously inaccessible. These are the businesses that gain new consumers simply by virtue of the nearly costless ability to find new suppliers, strike quicker agreements, or access new markets. These are the businesses that will suffer the greatest harm and bear the greatest risk if we are not able to come to a new safe harbor framework. Safe harbor cut down on the cost of compliance with the various state privacy regulations in the European Union. Without the shelter of a safe harbor, these businesses have the choice of operating at increased risk, paying expensive costs to lower that risk, or simply stopping the flow of information altogether. That is, stopping business altogether. Department of Commerce estimates in 2013, 60% of the 4,000 plus participants in the safe harbor framework were small or medium-sized enterprises spanning 102 different industry sectors. A break in the flow of data has the potential to cause real impacts to the economies on both sides of the proverbial pond. So I'm encouraged to hear that the negotiators on Safe Harbor 2.0 have reached an agreement in principle. That's really good news. And I cannot emphasize enough how important it is to reach a new and firm agreement before the grace period elapses in January. I'd like to thank our witnesses again for spending time to discuss their understanding of the impact of the ruling of the European Court of Justice. We welcome your thoughts and look forward to hearing from you. With that, I'd yield such time as the, I guess Mr. Barton didn't want any time. Thank you. So I yield back the balance of my time.
Chair, thanks, the gentleman. Gentleman yields back. Chair recognizes the ranking member of the full committee, Mr. Pallone of New Jersey. 4 minutes for an opening statement, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is the committee's second hearing on the topic of data moving across national borders. The digital movement of data affects consumers and businesses in both the United States and in Europe and in every country of the world. The U.S. leads the world in technological innovation. It has exported over $380 billion worth of digital services in 2012. Meanwhile, internet commerce grew threefold from 2011 to 2013 and is expected to reach $133 billion by 2018. And the economic relationship between the United States and the European Union is the strongest in the world. Since our December 2014 hearing on this issue, the big change is that the European Court of Justice invalidated the Safe Harbor Agreement between the United States and the European Union that allowed American companies to transfer European users' information to the U.S., and the elimination of the Safe Harbor has caused great uncertainty. However, as early as 2013, long before the Court's October 2015 decision, the 15-year-old agreement was under renegotiation. And during this time, the U.S. and the EU have been working hard to strengthen the privacy principles of the original agreement to ensure they cover the newest business models and data transfers that exist. Almost a year later, we today repeat our desire to see those negotiations completed. I urge the parties to quickly finalize a new agreement tailor-made for the modern economy and the modern consumer. A new agreement can and should improve consumer privacy and data security. Businesses can and should adhere to strong privacy principles from inception. Building trust with consumers worldwide requires a multifaceted approach through appropriate legislation and regulation, as well as through trade negotiations. And therefore, I also would urge this Congress to act by passing effective baseline privacy and data security protections. For the Internet of the future, economic gains and consumer protections go hand in hand. When consumers feel safe, that their personal information is protected, they do more business online. I hope that today's discussion, as well as the ongoing negotiations between the United States and the EU, will encourage a step in the right direction on data privacy, not only for Europeans, but for American citizens as well. We can have innovation and protections for consumer privacy. We have done it time and time again. There's no reason why it should be different in this space than in any other. In today's heavily digital commercial environment, cross-border data flows are not just a normal part of doing business, but essential to the American economy and American jobs. And I welcome this opportunity, Mr. Chairman, to discuss the value of secure and free data flow between the United States and Europe. I yield back.
The gentleman yields back. The chair thanks the gentleman for his comments. This concludes member opening statements. The chair would remind members that pursuant to committee rules, all members' opening statements will be made part of the record. Now, we do want to thank our witnesses for being here today, for taking time to testify before the subcommittee. You will each have an opportunity to give an opening statement. That will be followed by a round of questions from members. Our panel for today's hearing will include Ms. Victoria Espinel, President and CEO of the Business Software Alliance, Mr. Joshua Meltzer, Senior Fellow for Global Economy and Development at the Brookings Institution, Mr. Mark Rauthenberg, President of the Electronic Privacy Information Center, and Mr. John Murphy, Senior Vice President for International Policy at the United States Chamber of Commerce. We appreciate all of you being here with us today. We'll begin the panel with you, Ms. Espinel, and you are recognized for 5 minutes for a summary of your opening statement.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Chairman Burgess and Ranking Member Schakowsky, Chairman Walden and Ranking Member Eshoo, and members of both subcommittees. My name is Victoria Espinel. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today on behalf of BSA, the Software Alliance. BSA is the leading advocate for the global software industry in the United States and around the world. While the 19th century was powered by steam and coal, and the 20th century by electricity, cars, and computers, the 21st century runs on data. Today, data is at the core of nearly everything we touch: banking, genome mapping, teaching our children, and safely getting home from work and back again, all run on data. And this data economy is a global phenomena. People around the world are benefiting from data innovation. Accordingly, we recognize that as we proceed, we must be diligent to ensure personal privacy is fully respected and robust security measures are in place to guard the data involved. Barriers to the free movement of data undermine the benefits of the data economy. Recent developments in Europe present a significant challenge that must be taken seriously and warrants immediate action. Last month, the European Court of Justice struck down the Safe Harbor. The Safe Harbor set out rules that enabled nearly 5,000 American companies to provide a huge array of data services to European enterprises and individuals. Companies abiding by the Safe Harbor rules could easily and efficiently transfer data to the U.S. consistent with EU law. The European Court of Justice decision upended this process. The uncertainty about international data flows created by the European Court of Justice decision deters innovation and makes it much more difficult for our members to serve their millions of customers in Europe, which harms U.S. competitiveness. To address this, Congress and the U.S. government should engage immediately and actively with their European counterparts to restore stability in transatlantic data flows. Specifically, we need three things. First, rapid consensus on a new agreement to replace the Safe Harbor. Second, sufficient time to come into compliance with the new rules. And third, a framework in which the European Union and the United States can develop and agree on a sustainable long-term solution that reflects and advances the interests of all stakeholders. To the first point, fortunately, the United States and the EU were already deep in talks to revise the Safe Harbor Agreement when the European Court of Justice issued its decision. And to this, I want to join the chairman in thanking the Department of Commerce for all the hard work they have done on the negotiation thus far. The new version of the framework will include up-to-date safeguards. Updating the framework makes good sense. Much has changed since the Safe Harbor was first set up in the year 2000. The volume of data is increasing exponentially. Here is an incredible fact. More than 90% of the data that exists in the world today was created in the last 2 years alone. And that is a rate of change that will continue to increase exponentially. The volume of business data worldwide is doubling every 15 months. So these negotiations must continue, and a new safe harbor must be finalized quickly. Second, even if there is consensus on a new agreement, as we believe there will be, companies will need an appropriate standstill period in which to adapt their operations to the new legal realities. An appropriate standstill period is essential to consumers on both sides of the Atlantic. And finally, while a new agreement to replace the safe harbor is a vital and immediate step, it is not the complete solution to the larger issue of privacy protections in the digital age. We urge Congress and the United States government to look to the longer term. The European Court of Justice ruling set a standard of essential equivalence between privacy rules in Europe and the United States, in effect, a comparative analysis of our respective regimes. The European Court of Justice points most sharply at U.S. surveillance regimes put in place to protect our national security and their impact on individual privacy. Balancing these essential goals is a task this Congress has and will continue to consider. Most recently, the enactment of the USA Freedom Act is recognition that the balance is ever-changing and laws must stay up to date. Ultimately, however, essential equivalence in the pursuit of protecting privacy in a changing world will be a dynamic concept that will change as laws and practices evolve. We need a framework that is sustainable over the long term. The original safe harbor lasted nearly 15 years. To achieve that sort of stability, we will need to develop a more enduring solution for data transfers. The United States and Europe are not as far apart on privacy as some might think. Where there are gaps that span the Atlantic, whether perceived or actual, we can close those through a combination of dialogue and international commitments. And Congress will be a key part of enabling this to happen. Thank you again for providing this opportunity to share our views on these important matters, and I look forward to your questions.
Chair, thanks. Gentlelady, Dr. Metzler, you're recognized 5 minutes for an opening statement, please.
Chairman Burgess, Chairman Walden, Ranking Member Schakowsky, and Ranking Member Chu, honorable members of both committees, thank you for this opportunity to share my views with you on the Safe Harbor decision and the impacts for transatlantic data flows. Transatlantic data flows underpin and enable a significant amount of trade and investment. Where this concerns personal data of people in Europe, and it is subject, therefore, to European privacy laws. The Safe Harbor framework has allowed personal data to be transferred from the EU to the US, but as a result of a recent decision of the European Court of Justice, the ability to do this has been called into serious question. I will briefly outline the link now between data flows and transatlantic trade and investment and discuss the potential implications of this European Court of Justice decision. As has been noted already, the US-EU economic relationship is the most significant in the world. In 2014 alone, transatlantic trade was worth over $1 trillion. And we should also not forget the importance of the investment relationship, where the stock of investment in both jurisdictions is over $4 trillion. Data flows between the US and the EU are also the largest globally, 55% larger than data flows between the US and Asia alone. These data flows underpin and enable a significant amount of this bilateral economic relationship. Just to give you a couple of examples, businesses use internet platforms to reach customers in Europe. Internet access and the free flow of data supports global value chains, and data flows are essential when US companies with subsidiaries in Europe manage production schedule and human rights and HR data. The global nature of the internet is also creating new opportunities for small and medium-sized enterprises to engage in international trade. For example, 95% of those SMEs who use in the US that use eBay to sell goods and services to customers do so in more than four countries overseas. This compares with less than 5% of such businesses when they are exporting offline. And this is obviously important, as SMEs are the main drivers of job growth in the United States, accounting for 63% of net new private sector jobs since 2002. Unfortunately, there is only limited quantitative data on the impact of the internet and cross-border data flows on international trade. If we focus on services that can be delivered online, in 2012, US exported over 380 billion of such services, and over 140 billion of that went to the EU. So EU privacy laws require entities that are collecting personal data to comply with privacy principles. And when transferring this personal data outside of the EU, this can only be done under specific conditions. One of these is a finding from the European Commission that the receiving country provides an adequate level of privacy protection, which essentially requires that they have privacy laws equivalent to the EU. There are other forms, model contracts and binding corporate rules, though these are not well utilised. The US Safe Harbour framework has allowed for the transfer of personal data from the EU to the EU to the US, despite differences in approaches to privacy protection. In the recent TREMS decision, the European Court of Justice has effectively invalidated this mechanism for transferring personal data from the EU to the US. Now, in terms of its immediate impact of this decision, the European data privacy actors have said that they will wait until the end of January 2016 before enforcing TREMS. Since 2014, there has been an effort to renegotiate Safe Harbour, and certainly one solution here would be for the newly renegotiated Safe Harbour Agreement to address all the concerns that the European Court of Justice has outlined with the current Safe Harbour framework. However, until we know the outcome of these negotiations and, importantly, whether they are acceptable to the European Court of Justice, there will remain considerable legal uncertainty as to how transfers of personal data from the EU to the US can continue. Failure to find a way for companies to transfer personal data to the US can have significant economic repercussions. and these costs are likely to fall most heavily on small and medium-sized enterprises who lack the resources to navigate the complex legal issues and to manage the risk. In addition, some of the other mechanisms available for the transfer of personal data to the US, such as binding corporate rules, are often not available to small and medium-sized enterprises who do not have a corporate presence in the EU. I appreciate the opportunity to offer my views on this important issue and look forward to your questions.
Chair, thanks, gentlemen. Mr. Rotenberg, you're recognized for 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Schakowsky, Chairman Walden, members of the committee. Appreciate the opportunity to testify today. My name is Mark Rotenberg. I'm president of EPIC. I've also taught information privacy law at Georgetown for the past 25 years and studied closely the developments of the European Union privacy system. I need to explain that the safe harbor framework from the outset raised concerns among experts, and consumer organizations, and privacy officials, many of whom looked at the framework and saw a familiar set of principles, but were concerned about the enforcement of those principles. Over the last several years, there have been repeated calls on both sides of the Atlantic to update and strengthen the safe harbor framework. In our comments to the Federal Trade Commission, we routinely asked the agency to incorporate strong privacy principles to give meaning to the safe harbor framework, but the agency was reluctant to do so. And so, to us and others, the judgment of the European Court of Justice did not come as a surprise. The problems with safe harbor were familiar. But I should explain also, this approach to data protection in Europe is familiar in the United States. The European regulators are trying to protect a consumer interest, which is data protection set out in the Charter of Fundamental Rights, and attempting to hold foreign companies to the same standards that they would hold domestic companies. We do the same thing in the US with product safety, consumer products, automobiles. Emission standards, for example, must be equally enforced against foreign auto suppliers as they are against US firms, because US firms should not have to carry a cost that foreign firms would not. This is essential to understanding the notion of adequacy, essential equivalence, in the judgment of the European Court of Justice. But another key point to make, which I set out in the testimony on pages 10 and 11, is the language in the Charter of Fundamental Rights. This is the European Bill of Rights, and they have set out both privacy and data protection as cornerstone rights within their legal system, one protecting the right to privacy, and the other explicitly saying that everyone has the right to the protection of personal data, such data must be processed fairly, and such compliance must be ensured by an independent authority. Now, I know it would be tempting in the context of the current discussion to imagine that a Safe Harbor 2.0 could address the challenge that the European Court of Justice has set out. But my sense is that that approach will not be adequate, because part of what the European Court of Justice has identified is also the concern shared by US consumer groups, privacy experts, and others, that the US has not updated its privacy law. The data not only on European citizens, but also on US citizens, lacks adequate protection. And that's why in my testimony today, I am strongly recommending that you consider long overdue updates to domestic privacy law, that you not simply see this as a trade issue. I propose, for example, 4 specific steps I believe Congress could take that over the long term would solve not only the safe harbor problem, but would be good for US consumers and for US business. Specifically, I think the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights, which the President has proposed and reflects many privacy bills that have gone through this committee, is a good starting point. I think updates to the US Privacy Act would make a lot of sense. I know they're already under consideration by Congress. I think the creation of an independent data protection agency in the US is long overdue and could help address concerns on both sides of the Atlantic. And finally, I think we do need an international framework to ensure transborder data flows not only between the EU and the US, but among all of our trading partners around the world, because we are today in a global economy. Now, I know you may think this is just the view of perhaps privacy people or consumer groups, but I'd like to share with you the views that have recently been expressed by leaders of the internet industry. It was Microsoft President Brad Smith who, after the decision of the European Court of Justice, said privacy is a fundamental human right. It is Apple CEO Tim Cook who said just 2 weeks ago on NPR, privacy is a fundamental human right. These are the exact same words of the European Court of Justice. This is the view of US consumer groups. I believe on both sides of the Atlantic, there is consensus for the view that privacy is a fundamental right. Thank you.
Chair, thanks to the gentleman. Mr. Murphy, you're recognized for 5 minutes, please.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Schakowsky, distinguished members of the committee, it's an honor to appear before you this morning on behalf of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, the nation's largest business association representing companies of every size, sector, and state. And it is representing those companies that I'd like to share my comments. We've spoken this morning about the importance of the international movement of data and how important it is to companies of all kinds. I can speak on behalf of this dynamic and multifaceted array of member companies to confirm that. Examples of data flows take many forms, including a small exporter operating through an e-commerce portal, a large company with operations in multiple countries managing its human resources, a wind turbine sending data on its performance to the engineers who keep it running, or a transatlantic tourist using a credit card. In short, today's hearing isn't really just about internet companies, but about companies. It isn't about the internet economy, it's about the economy. However, as we've heard, the tremendous benefits of transatlantic data flows are now at risk. The invalidation of the Safe Harbor Agreement raises serious questions. I would point out that before its decision, the European Court of Justice did not conduct any formal investigation into U.S. current surveillance oversight. In fact, the decision was based largely on process concerns internal to the European Union. Even so, more than 4,000 companies have been left asking whether they can continue to transfer personal data from Europe. They're now faced with the tough choice of deciding whether to continue their transatlantic business or face potentially costly enforcement actions. While companies in the Safe Harbor program continue to guarantee a high level of data protection for the users of their products and services, alternatives cannot be devised overnight. Data privacy systems are complex, legally and technically. One alternative suggested by the European Commission, binding corporate rules, can cost over $1 million and take at least 18 months to develop and implement. This is a non-starter for small businesses. Or consider a U.S. hotel chain with locations across Europe, each of which works with a host of small businesses that might provide food for their in-house restaurant or janitorial services. All of those relationships involve data flows. And that means there are hundreds of arrangements across hundreds of properties that may need to change at considerable cost. Another example comes from the auto industry, which uses Safe Harbor to identify vehicle safety issues and for quality and development purposes. However, the industry now faces the challenge of meeting both U.S. and EU regulatory requirements, which may diverge. Under U.S. law, auto manufacturers must share vehicle identification numbers of cars sold globally in the event of a vehicle service campaign, such as a recall. This U.S. obligation may now conflict with EU privacy rules. So what's the outlook? Companies may be faced with a patchwork of 28 different enforcement and compliance regimes in different EU member states or more where local governments are involved. There's a serious disconnect between the EU's stated goals of spurring innovation and fostering a startup culture and statements by some European officials about the need for IT independence and calls for data localization. Further, some in Europe are trying to use legitimate concerns about data protection as an excuse for protectionism, and the uncertainty facing business worsens. This approach has been frequently rebuked by many others in the EU, but it merits careful scrutiny. While the business community is committed to working with our European colleagues to ensure a balanced and proportionate system of rules, we must be vigilant. We must ensure that the European Union does not hold the United States to a different standard on national security and law enforcement issues. Specifically, what should be done? First, we need a new and improved safe harbor agreement that reflects current circumstances. The Chamber greatly appreciates the efforts of the Department of Commerce and the FTC to provide clarity and reach an agreement on a revised safe harbor. Further, we applaud the House for taking an important first step towards resolving related concerns with the passage of the Judicial Redress Act, and we are encouraging the Senate to act swiftly to give this bill final passage. The recently announced umbrella agreement is also another important step forward, allowing data sharing in certain circumstances between law enforcement and national security agencies. Also important are other safeguards instituted in the United States in recent years that provide a level of protection equivalent to or even greater than that found in the European Union and among its member states. The Chamber appreciates the opportunity to provide these comments to the committee, and we stand ready to assist in any way possible to ensure data flows can continue across the Atlantic.
The Chair thanks the gentleman for his testimony and thank all of you for your being here this morning and sharing your thoughts with us. We're going to move into the questions part of the hearing, and I'm going to begin by recognizing Mr. Walden 5 minutes for his questions.
Please. I thank the Chairman. I thank all of you for your testimony. It's most enlightening and helpful as we wrestle with this issue ourselves. Ms. Espinel and Mr. Murphy, do you think the Department of Commerce needs to be doing anything differently to arrive at safe harbor framework that will stand up to scrutiny by the European legal system? And if so, what would that be?
So I would say, first, I want to thank the Department of Commerce for all the work they've been doing in negotiating the safe harbor. And our understanding is that talks are well underway, and we are at the moment cautiously optimistic that we, meaning the United States and the European Union, will be able to find our way to a new safe harbor agreement. And so on that, I think the Department of Commerce is doing all that they can. I would continue to urge Congress to encourage the Department of Commerce to focus on that, and also to the extent you're speaking to your European counterparts, to encourage the Europeans to come to a speedy conclusion on a new safe harbor agreement. But I would also say that a new safe harbor agreement, while I think it is the immediate short-term step that we need, it will not solve the larger issue. And so I think we need to focus first and foremost at the moment on resolution of a new safe harbor agreement, but I think we need to quickly turn to coming up with a longer-term, more sustainable global solution for data transfers. And that is something that we would like to be working with Congress on, and we'll be working closely with the Department of Commerce, the FTC, as well as the governments of the European Union and the European Commission.
All right, Mr. Murphy.
I would agree with those comments, just briefly. The Department of Commerce has made every effort to get ahead of this problem. In fact, before the European Court of Justice decision had advanced significantly towards reaching a new agreement. Obviously, further negotiations were required after the ruling came out to reflect those findings. But they've done a good job, and they've done a good job reaching out to the business community to gather their input as well.
Okay. Dr. Meltzer, what impacts will continuing uncertainty around transatlantic data flows have on foreign direct investment, both in the United States and the European Union, from your perspective?
Thank you for the question. I think it's important to recognize that the implications of the Schrems decision at the moment are going to be direct on those who are certified under the safe harbor framework, but the implications are potentially a lot more significant. We already see in the EU, for instance, that some of the data protection authorities in Germany have effectively stated that the other mechanisms that the EU has for transferring data, namely standard model contracts and binding corporate rules themselves, are unlikely to be available for transferring personal data to the EU. So effectively, there is enormous legal uncertainty around the whole process and available options for making this to happen. So one would expect that for the moment, all forms of foreign investment that essentially are relying and incorporating the transfer of personal data are going to have to be reviewing their processes, and a lot of investment decisions and trade is going to be placed under that sort of higher level of risk and uncertainty for the time being.
And as I noted in some of the testimony too, it's not just the EU anymore. I mean, other countries are looking at this, what the EU has concluded, and now they're starting to question whether their own safe harbor agreements were correct. And somebody tell me how this is spreading and what we need to be cognizant of going forward. Mr. Rottenberg.
Thank you, Mr. Walden. I do discuss in my prepared statement efforts that actually preceded the judgment of the European Court in Canada, in Japan, and South Korea. And part of the point that I'm trying to make today is that this is not simply a matter of trade policy. In other words, where countries have established fundamental rights, they will see a need to protect those rights. And the second part of the Schrems decision doesn't just invalidate safe harbor, it says that each one of the national data protection agencies has the authority to enforce fundamental rights, which means even an agreement between the Department of Commerce and the Commission could be challenged by a member country.
But if I could just add briefly, there are a number of countries around the world that are looking to put or considering putting trade barriers in place to restrict the movement of data across national borders for a variety of reasons. This is a fight that we have been fighting for at least 5 years now, market to market around the world. I think one of the recent inventories of countries that are considering put the number at 18, including significant trading partners such as China, but also Russia, Nigeria, and a number of other trading partners. So while the subject of this hearing is the US-EU safe harbor, and that is a subject of great concern to us, there is a larger issue here, I think, about setting up a global framework that allows data to move freely around the world beyond just the United States
and
Europe.
My time has expired.
Chair, the gentleman yields back. Chair, thanks the gentleman for his questions. Chair recognizes the gentlelady from Illinois, the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Commerce, Manufacturing, and Trade. 5 minutes for questions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's been reported that the Department of Commerce and the European Union have agreed, at least in broad strokes, on a replacement for safe harbor. And like you, I support passage of a comprehensive privacy bill and a comprehensive data security bill. However, I also hope that the new deal for safe harbor can be reached soon and that it will contain significant protections for consumers. Mr. Rottenberg, in answering the following, please put aside your call for changes to domestic law for a moment. I'll ask you that question a bit later. But in your opinion, what should be in the new agreement, if there's to be a new agreement, to afford consumers stronger privacy protections?
It's a difficult question to answer. There are 13 specific proposals that were presented by the European Commission to the Department of Commerce, and the Department of Commerce and the FTC has tried in this negotiation to address the issues that have been raised. But the reason that it's a difficult question to answer, as other witnesses have pointed out, is that neither the Commerce Department nor the FTC has legal authority over the surveillance activities undertaken by police or intelligence agencies in the United States. And you could say that's kind of a deal breaker on the European side, because it's explicit in the opinion of the Court of Justice that there must be legal authority to restrict that type of mass surveillance. Now, I won't go into that debate right now, but the question that you've asked, which is how do you solve the issues that have been identified post-ruling in the safe harbor negotiation, I actually don't think there's an answer to. And this even puts aside my recommendation for changes in domestic law. I think that's the reality on the European side as they look at next steps in this process.
So in your recommendations for changes in the domestic law, you aren't looking at the issue of government surveillance?
Well, certainly, yes. I mean, the Freedom Act was a significant step forward for privacy protection in the United States, but it limited only the surveillance activities directed toward U.S. persons. That's the 215 collection program. The Freedom Act did not address the 702 program, which is collection directed toward non-U.S. persons. And that remains a key concern on the EU side. And I don't think that the Department of Commerce can negotiate that in the context of a Safe Harbor 2.0. So at a minimum, I think that would have to be done to comply with the judgment of the court.
So there have been various press accounts, and of course the terms of the new agreement have not been made public, but are there certain provisions that you do consider helpful? For example, we've heard that there will be increased transparency Is that something that you think would be helpful?
It would be good, but to be fair, in the original safe harbor proposal, which we were involved with, we actually favored the principles. We said these are familiar principles. They exist both on the U.S. side and on the European side, and they seem like a good basis to promote transborder data flows. We were not against the principles in the original safe harbor, but the problem was the lack of enforcement. And you see, the lack of enforcement issue continues even in the safe harbor 2.0, because unless the Federal Trade Commission, or as I've proposed, an independent data protection agency, has the authority to enforce those principles, it won't have a significant impact on how it's viewed on the European side. But I agree, I think the steps are in the right direction, but they don't solve the enforcement problem.
In April, Mr. Rush, Congressman Rush, and I offered an amendment in the nature of a substitute to the Data Security and Breach Notification Act that would require commercial entities that own or possess consumers' personal information to create and implement security procedures to safeguard that data. Among other things, those procedures would have to include processes for identifying, preventing, and correcting security vulnerabilities. Is this important in domestic?
Yes. Actually, I think that's a very important proposal because there's increasing awareness on both sides of the Atlantic of the need for data breach notification. The Europeans have recently updated their law in part in response to developments that have taken place in U.S. law. And I think your proposal would carry that process forward in a way that's favorable, again, for consumers and businesses. I don't think this is a process that puts consumers against business. I think we're all on the same page wanting to maintain transborder data flows. So to the extent that these changes help strengthen consumer confidence, I think it's a step in the right direction.
Thank you. I'd like to have further conversations with you at another time. Thank you very much. I yield back.
Chair, thanks, the gentlelady, and Chair will recognize himself. 5 minutes for questions. Dr. Meltzer, you indicated in your testimony that cross-border data flows affect small and medium-sized business. Can you give us an idea as to what that effect is?
So the effect is in multiple ways. I apologize for some generality. As I mentioned in my opening statement, there is unfortunately a paucity of very hard data on this issue. eBay, I mentioned, has been particularly helpful in providing data about the way that small businesses export on its platform, and I think it's a good example because it captures a lot of the ways that small businesses are using the internet to access customers globally, and that's certainly the case when it comes to transatlantic trade. And so there's one example where there's a lot of new opportunities for engagement in the global economy by small businesses that really was not possible before, that relies on cross-border data flows, will have a component of that which is certainly personal data and which is going to be significantly potentially inhibited by the ruling in the Schrems decision. And as I think has been mentioned before, this is an issue which is transatlantic specific but is global in its implications. One of the things I think is worth recognizing is also that there's essentially a global debate going on about the appropriate form of privacy model protection going forward. There is the US version, which is essentially embodied in the APEC cross-border privacy principles, and there is the EU approach, and both models are being discussed in different form globally, and different countries are looking at different approaches, and which way they go will have a significant impact on how small businesses operate, not only on a transatlantic basis, but how they use the internet to leverage and engage globally in all countries around the world.
Well, along those lines, then, the benefits that occur to small and medium-sized enterprises, they're not unique to the United States-European Union relationship.
No, absolutely not. And in many respects, the opportunities for small and medium-sized enterprises are as real here as they are in Europe, as they are actually in a range of other countries, including specifically developing countries, which were being able to engage in international trade in a way that was not possible. So the potential implications of this are much broader than the transatlantic nature, certainly broader than for the SME sector here in the US, but certainly globally.
Thank you, and I thank you for those answers. Mr. Murphy, The Chamber of Commerce obviously represents a broad range of interests across the country. Can you give us a sense what you're hearing from your members, how important it is that the United States and the European Union reach a new agreement on a new safe harbor?
Well, it's indispensable. The US-EU economic relationship is without peer in the world today. And as I think several members of the committee have pointed out, bilateral trade is $1 trillion annually. But that doesn't even capture the additional $5 trillion in sales by US affiliates in Europe or European affiliates in the United States. There is no relationship like that. US investment in Europe is 40 times what US companies have invested directly in China. So getting this right matters for all kinds of companies. I think for small businesses, they're just waking up to it. Dr. Meltzer's comments about eBay and the large number of companies that use that platform as exporters and the uncertainty about what that would mean for them. But I think that there are potential hidden costs for many small businesses as well. For instance, I gave my example about a hotel chain operating in Europe and the many small businesses which provide services to that hotel. Certainly many of them have never thought about this. In the absence of a revised safe harbor agreement, companies may face an incentive to bring that kind of work in-house, and that could be very damaging for small businesses going forward.
So what's the current state of risk for your members, and then further, is that level of risk sustainable for them?
I think that we're going through a bit of a state of shock here in the wake of the ruling. There was a wide expectation that the ruling might be in some way adverse. I think the full dimensions of it were not fully appreciated in advance. So there is a circling of the wagons right now to try and work with the authorities to find a solution in the near term. I do agree with Ms. Espinel, though, that this is an issue that even in the happy event that we're able to achieve in the next weeks or a couple of months, a new safe harbor agreement, this issue is going to require constant attention to get it right on a global level.
And thank you for your responses. Chair yields back and recognizes Mr. McInerney. 5 minutes for questions, please.
I thank the chair, and I thank the witnesses. Very interesting hearing this morning. Mr. Rotenberg, there, in my mind, there's a significant distinction between government surveillance on the one hand and data breach from non-state actors, businesses, or so on the other hand, that are trying to get information that they shouldn't have. Which do you feel is more significant in the SHRM decision?
Well, the SHRM's decision looks primarily at a commercial trade framework, which is what Safe Harbor was, and concludes that that trade framework did not meet the adequacy requirement of European law. So in that respect, I guess you could say it's commercial. But you see, from the European perspective, because privacy is a fundamental right, the question of who gets access to it in some respects is not as significant. It's the underlying privacy interest. So both will remain important. The European privacy officials will look to whether the personal data that's being collected is used for impermissible reasons, either on the commercial side or on the intelligence side.
Have you been keeping up with the exceptional access question here in the United States?
I'm not sure if I understand the question.
Well, the FBI and other organizations want to have an encryption key,
right,
that's accessible to them so that they can look at data with proper warrant provisions. Do you think that would hurt our businesses?
Well, I certainly think that would be a mistake. I understand the Bureau's concern. We've had this discussion for many, many years. But the risk, of course, of the so-called key escrow approach to encryption is that you leave systems vulnerable to,
right,
cyber criminals. In the best of circumstances, you can execute your lawful investigation. But we know from experience there are many other scenarios, and those weaknesses will be exploited.
Well, what are some of the differences then between data protection in the U.S. and data protection in Europe?
Well, I actually think there's much more similarity between the two approaches than people commonly think. The European Union privacy law mirrors many of our own privacy laws, our Fair Credit Reporting Act, our Privacy Act. All of these U.S. laws have many of the same principles that the Europeans do. The difference, I think, is that we have not updated our laws as the Europeans have. So the divide that you're seeing today is really not one about disagreement as to what privacy protection means. It's really a divide over the scope of application.
Well, thank you. One more question for you. Do you have specific recommendations then for data privacy? It sounds like what you're saying is that we really should be more proactive in terms of keeping up the scope of the problem.
I think we should update our national law. I mean, again, it's obvious there's no benefit to consumers to see the disruption of transporter data flows. Everyone wants to ensure that the data flows continue. But we also know that the weaknesses in U.S. privacy protections will continue even with a new safe harbor. So there has to be within the United States an effort to update our privacy law, I believe.
Thank you. Ms. Espinel, will American service members stationed in Europe be able to communicate as easily with their loved ones here in the United States absent safe harbor?
That's an excellent question. And I think it's, you know, there are clearly going to be a number of impacts, and I'm happy to speak to those. I think we don't know today what the full extent of those impacts will be, but communication between the United States and Europe, I think, is clearly one of the things that could be implicated, among a number of other things as well.
Well, how can U.S. companies ensure that our service members are not cut off from their families?
So I would say there are three things that we need to happen. The first is one that we've talked about already today, which is that we need to come to a new resolution for the safe harbor. So that is sort of a first immediate step. The United States and Europe need to come together to agree on a new safe harbor. The second thing that we need is we need some appropriate amount of time for U.S. companies to be able to come into compliance with those new regulations. And then, as we've been discussing today, we need to be actively working on what a long-term sustainable solution is going to be. I think we are all in agreement that while it is enormously important to come to a new agreement on the safe harbor as quickly as possible, that will not be our long-term solution, and we need to be working together on a long-term sustainable solution.
So you pivoted back to your opening remarks then on the three things that we need to do.
I think those are the three things that we need to keep a laser focus on.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Chair, thanks to the gentleman. The gentleman yields back. Chair recognizes the gentlelady from Tennessee, Ms. Blackburn, 5 minutes for questions, please.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for answering the questions and being right to the point. We appreciate that. Mr. Meltzer, I wanted to come to you, your October 2014 working paper on transatlantic data flows, some great stats in there, and they really cause you to think when you look at the worth of the digitally exported services and how that does affect our trade. So thank you for that and for making that available. I want to go back to something Chairman Burgess was beginning to push on a little bit, the short and long-term consequences as we look at solidifying a safe harbor framework. And back to the issue of U.S. businesses, whether they're large or small. And let's talk about between now and January 2016 and what the impact is going to be as you've got that Article 29 working party trying to finalize the safe harbor agreement. So I'd like to hear from you, just let's narrow this focus down and look at these businesses between now and January 2016. We know the volume that is being exported, and look at what you think the impact is going to be, and then what consequences do you see arising if a new safe harbor agreement is unable to be finalized? So,
yeah, thank you for that question. So, to the first part, assuming that the data protection authorities, all of them, stick to the commitment not to enforce the SREMS decision until the end of January 2016, then we are presumably still in a reasonable status quo environment and data flows should continue, though under a certain amount of increased uncertainty post January. The question is going to be what, you know, whether safe harbour has been concluded. But as I think the witnesses have said, I think even with conclusion of safe harbour, it is still ultimately going to be a question of whether that satisfies the European Court of Justice. And this will most likely have to be ultimately settled again by the European Court of Justice, because the data protection authorities have been given the clear authority to investigate complaints regarding adequacy of data flows. So I would imagine a situation, even after concluded Safe Harbour 2.0, where you still get data protection authorities, you know, looking into whether in fact there is adequacy. So this is certainly going to increase the risk environment. It's also, stepping back a little bit, I think that there is an interest, clearly a significant interest on the US side to make sure that this is resolved. I think there's an equally important interest on the EU side to resolve this issue as well. The costs to the EU economy are also going to be very significant if they don't manage to resolve this transborder data flow issue. So I think those two dynamics give me some hope that a solution is going to be found, but a number of steps I think are going to have to be taken before that is going to be clear.
Okay. Ms. Espinel, do you think they'll reach an agreement, and what do you see as the stumbling blocks?
We are, as I said, confident or strongly, cautiously optimistic that the Department of Commerce and the European Union will be able to come to an agreement. All indications are that the discussions are going well, and as Dr. Meltzer pointed out, there are very strong interests on both sides of the Atlantic to coming to an agreement. So, you know, while not wanting to diminish the difficulties inherent in that, we do believe that they will come to an agreement in the short term. Although I feel duty-bound to emphasize that we also believe that the short-term agreement will not be the end of this discussion, that we will need to come up with a long-term solution, you know, both to serve the interests of larger companies, but also to serve the interests of the many small and medium-sized businesses that are affected by this, and the millions of customers on both sides of the Atlantic that are affected.
Thank you. I am out of time, but I'm going to submit a question for answer dealing with transfer rights, which I think is something that we probably should be having a discussion on also. So I'll yield back.
Gentlelady yields back to chair. Thanks, the gentlelady. Chair recognizes the gentlelady from New York, Ms. Clark. 5 minutes for questions, please.
I thank the chairman, Mr. Burgess, and I thank our witnesses for their testimony this morning. Ms. Espinel, we know that big companies will likely be able to use their legal and technical solutions to get by without safe harbor. But what about small businesses? And do small businesses have the resources and expertise necessary to implement alternatives?
So that's a fantastic question. And as has been pointed out earlier in this hearing, most of the companies that are affected by the safe harbors are small and medium companies. You know, there's two different aspects of this. One way, obviously, to try to deal with this is to build data centers around the world. That is a solution that is out of reach to all but the very largest of companies around the world. It's also a very inefficient way to do remote computing and data analytics. In fact, it's only inefficient, it is impossible if information is siloed in different locations. So that is not an option for the smaller companies. And the difficulties of living in a world where there is a patchwork of regulations is even harder for smaller companies to deal with. It is no picnic for the larger companies, to be sure, but I think it is impossible for smaller companies. And I think, you know, one of the things that it does is there's enormous efficiencies from remote computing, from cloud computing, from data analytics that benefit big companies, but they also benefit small companies in some ways even more. As Chairman Walden said, 75% of the value add there is to traditional industries, and there are many small companies across all economic sectors that are affected by this, and putting a shadow over what is still relatively nascent industries, cloud computing and data analytics at this point, I think it's hard to actually measure what the negative impact of that would be going forward.
So if you were to advise small companies given what we know right now in the negotiations, what sort of infrastructure or construct would you advise these smaller companies to begin looking at?
So as I said, some options are just completely out of the reach of small companies. I think what the small companies need is in line with what we would recommend generally. We all of us need to have a new safe harbor agreement in place. We all of us need some appropriate amount of time to come into compliance with those new regulations. And then we all need a long-term solution that's going to work. And that long-term solution, I think, needs to have at least three aspects to it. One, we've talked a lot about the importance of privacy. I think it's important that whatever long-term solution there is, it provides that a person's personal data will attract the same level of protection as it moves across borders. We need to have a solution that will allow law enforcement to do the job that it needs to do and protect citizens around the world. And we need to have a solution that will reduce the amount of legal uncertainty that exists right now, not just for big companies, but for small companies as well.
So, Mr. Murphy, given that safe harbor rulings impact on small businesses, are your organizations doing anything to ensure that small businesses have the understanding, expertise, resources necessary to continue their business operations without a safe harbor agreement?
Well, at present, the circumstances don't really provide workable alternatives. As I mentioned in my testimony, the European Commission, in the wake of the ruling by the European Court of Justice, indicated that one valid alternative is to use what's called binding corporate rules. But as Cam Carey, the former general counsel at the Department of Commerce, has pointed out, implementing these can cost $1 million and can take 18 months. This is completely out of the reach of most of our small business members. While larger companies may be able to move in some cases to adopt such an approach, there's really no alternative for the small companies to a revised safe harbor agreement.
Have any of you panelists, only have a few seconds left, given any thought to sort of the nuance that has to be an agreement that would address the concerns of small business in our country?
We haven't discussed is the role of innovation in the internet economy. And our view is that privacy rules would actually encourage innovation, particularly with small firms. And what I have in mind is to the extent that small and medium enterprises can develop their services in a way that minimizes the privacy risk, it also reduces the regulatory burden. Because what happens when people look closely at these data protection assessments, they ask, what kind of data is being collected? Is the credit card information secure? Do you need the social security number? I think small businesses can actually compete in this space by coming up with business practices that are actually model practices for privacy protection. That's what I would recommend.
Gentlelady yields back the chair. Thanks. The gentlelady chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, the chairman emeritus, Mr. Barton. 5 minutes for questions, please.
I want to thank both chairmen for this joint hearing, and it's a very important topic. I'm in a little bit of a dilemma. I'm the long-term co-chairman of the Congressional House Privacy Caucus, and I'm also a pro-business Republican. So if I put my pro-business hat on, I want to renegotiate this safe harbor agreement as quickly as possible with as little muss and fuss as possible. But if I put my privacy caucus co-chairman hat on, I think the European Union has highlighted a substantial issue, and that the U.S. privacy laws aren't as strong as they could be, and people like me think they should be. So I guess my first question to Mr. Rotenberg would be, what is the primary difference between the European Union privacy protections for their citizens and the privacy protection currently under law here in the United States?
Well, first of all, Mr. Barton, I actually wanted to thank you for all of your work as a pro-business Republican in support of consumer privacy. I think you helped demonstrate that in this country, privacy is actually a bipartisan issue, and it is compatible with business. But I think the point you make is also critical, which is that the Europeans have brought attention to areas of U.S. privacy law where we have more work to do. We have a good framework. Our Privacy Act of 74 is a good law. Our Fair Credit Reporting Act of 1970 is a good law, but these are old laws. They have not been updated. We really haven't thought yet about biometric identification, genetic data, facial recognition, you know, secretive profiling of consumers. These are real issues, and the Europeans have spent the last decade trying to understand how to protect privacy while promoting innovation. So my answer is I think we should continue down the road, which we actually started in the US, which is protecting privacy in law, but keep moving forward. I think the European decision provides that opportunity.
Under the current negotiations that are going on between the US and the European Union to come up with a new safe harbor agreement, does the US delegation have the authority to make substantive changes in U.S. policy, or are we trying to finesse the substantive disagreement and come up with just a better administrative solution?
I think it will ultimately be for Congress to make the changes in U.S. law that are necessary to provide adequate protection, not only for the European customers of U.S. businesses, but also for the U.S. customers of U.S. businesses.
Mr. Murphy, do you agree with that?
Our read of the ruling of the European Court of Justice is that it was fundamentally a federalism issue within Europe, having to do with the role of the European Commission on privacy versus the role of the data protection agencies in the 28 member states. And to a significant degree, the renegotiation of the safe harbor reflects their need to reorganize how they address privacy and the dissatisfaction with how it was handled by the Commission. That is a complex process. Federalism is always complicated. I don't have to tell a member of Congress. But the ruling itself was more process related and about those issues than it was about U.S. privacy protections. After all, there was no comprehensive examination of U.S. privacy law in the context of the European Court of Justice ruling.
Well, Mr. Chairman, it's rare that there's not a silver lining in every issue, and this is an example of where, in the short term, we want to work with our negotiators to solve this problem, because small businesses and large businesses all over the United States need access to the European market and need to be able to transfer data and information seamlessly back and forth. But in the somewhat longer term, perhaps it will give impetus to this committee and the Congress to address some of the fundamental issues and hopefully come up with stronger privacy protections for our citizens. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Chair thanks the gentleman. Chair recognizes the gentlelady from California, Ms. Eshoo. 5 minutes for questions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I apologize to the witnesses that I have to step out. There is a memorial service for, I just think, one of the greatest individuals that ever served in the Congress, the late Congressman Don Edwards. So I hope that the questions that I ask haven't already been asked. If they have been, it's because I had to step out. First of all, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to ask for unanimous consent to submit for the record a November 3rd letter from the Internet Association to the chairs and the ranking members of CMT and CMT subcommittees.
Without objection, so ordered.
And I thank you for that. I mentioned in my opening statement what I think is a major issue in this on the part of the EU, and that is what type of access the European data and American intelligence agencies, what should be given over, because there is a very, very large issue. I mean, it's like right under the sheets, and that is that, you all know what has taken place. relative to the surveillance and what was carried in the mainstream press, where American companies' products were stopped from being shipped, things were inserted in those products, repackaged and sent off. Now that is a I believe, and others believe, really damaging to the brand American product. And the Europeans are deeply suspicious of that. So first of all, what I'd like to ask you is, how would you handle that with the EU? Do you believe that there should be an adjustment on the part of our country, because this is a big concern of theirs? And if so, how so? And so just go quickly, if we might, so I just get a flavor from each one of you what your thinking is on this issue.
So I would just say quickly, that is clearly something that the opinion focused on as well. I think we need to, and that's why we've been focusing on, we need a short-term solution, but we also need a long-term solution, because we know that negotiation of the safe harbor will not address all of the larger issues, including that one. USA Freedom Act, I think, was a good example of our Congress being able to balance privacy and national security. So we would be looking to work with Congress on those issues in the future, and we are confident.
Do you think
that
the Europeans understand the steps that we took very well, or do you think do you know of those conversations having taken place, so that the knowledge is deeper and broader? So, I don't think we cured everything. Most frankly, we really never do, because you have to develop consensus, and these are tough issues, but.
So I think that is a fantastic point. And I think one of the things that we really need is to have a political environment that has, that is cooperative and constructive. And so one of the things that I would respectfully urge Congress to do, when you're talking to your counterparts in the European Union, that I would urge the administration to do, that we can do as well, is to help the Europeans understand our privacy system better, including some of the recent improvements, like the USA Freedom Act. Mm-hmm. I take this opportunity to thank you all for voting for the Judicial Redress Act, and hope that the Senate follows your leadership on that.
Great. Let me just get one more in, and to you and to others. This weekend, the CEO and co-founder of Virtru authored an op-ed in VentureBeat, in which he suggested that encryption and anonymization as ways to adapt to the EU's new data rules. Do you agree? Do you disagree? Do you think it's helpful? Do you think it will serve
exactly,
our interests?
Yes, this is almost exactly the point I was making to Congresswoman Clark. I actually think both of those techniques, encryption and anonymization, provide an opportunity for internet-based businesses mm-hmm. to minimize their privacy burdens. I think it would be a
Has anyone taken this on voluntarily that
very
you know
good,
of?
Step forward.
Any companies, to your knowledge, taken this on voluntarily?
In terms of encryption?
To adopt these practices?
So I would just say that many of our companies care deeply about privacy. Many of them have adopted various encryption practices in order to protect their customers' data.
Mm-hmm. Thank you to the witnesses again, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlelady yields back to chair. Thanks, the gentlelady. Chair recognizes the gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Lance, Vice Chairman of the Commerce, Manufacturing, and Trade Subcommittee. 5 minutes for questions.
Thank you, Chairman, and good morning to the distinguished panel. And I commend you, Mr. Chairman, and the other chairman, Mr. Walden, for this very important hearing. This is obviously a challenge based upon the decision, but I think we have the expertise and the bipartisan cooperation, particularly in this committee, to overcome the challenge and to work together to an effective solution. And I guess in the short term or intermediate term, it's the negotiations now occurring. But then moving forward, my estimate would be is that we probably ultimately need legislation. I'd like the view of each member of the panel on whether I'm correct on that, current negotiations, but then perhaps we will have to have legislation as well. To each member of the distinguished panel.
So in terms of having a long-term sustainable
yes.
global solution, we'll need to work with a number of countries on that, including the United States. I would say I don't want to dismiss the improvements that have been made to our legislation recently in the last couple of years and beyond legislation such as the President's Order Number 28 and increase FTC enforcement. I do think we may need to look at other legislative options in the future. And we would obviously like to be working closely with Congress on that. But I think in order to come up with a global framework, we will be needing to work with governments around the world to either update their systems or to have a principle-based approach that is flexible enough that it can work within all of our systems.
Thank you. Dr. Meltz.
Yeah, I think I agree that a significant amount of progress has been made here domestically. I mean, the issues around surveillance and collecting personal data is one which is obviously important domestically and has been driven by domestic factors rather than, you know, what the EU wants the US to do, and I think that will continue to be the case. This discussion with the EU tends to be a bit distorted because the European Commission has no authority over national security issues. So what is missing in this debate on the EU side is actually the fact that their national security agencies are more or less doing very much what the NSA does and probably with a lot less due process. So we need to remember that this is not necessarily... the US has got a particular balance between national security and privacy which is working through, and this debate is also needs to be, I think, invigorated when we talk about this in the EU context as well.
And before answering Mr. Rodenberg, let me say I share Chairman Emeritus Barton's concerns regarding privacy, and I think it's certainly possible to be a business-centric, relatively conservative Republican and greatly interested in privacy, and I think it's also possible, obviously, on the other side, on the Democratic side. So your views as to whether we will need legislation ultimately.
Thank you. I'm quite certain you will need legislation, and let me tell you what I think will happen
yes, sir.
If you don't have legislation.
Yes, sir.
If you only have a revised Safe Harbor 2.0, and you don't address the 702 problem, and wait till 2017 when that expires, and you don't solve the problem that the FTC actually doesn't have enforcement, I think you will almost immediately see European data protection agencies attack the revised agreement. So to have a meaningful agreement that addresses the concerns that have been set out in the court's opinion, you have to do at least those two things. You have to update 702, and you need enforcement authority for the FTC.
Thank you. Mr. Murphy, and I'm certainly interested in the view of the Chamber of Commerce because you represent what's best in America in our entrepreneurial spirit.
Well, thank you. Certainly, if it's in the realm of a pro-business conservative to support privacy in businesses as well.
Of course.
Privacy is indispensable.
Of course.
And companies take this very seriously. I would just add a clarification, though, that with regard to whether or not there should be further privacy legislation in the United States, the ruling of the European Court of Justice does not provide a roadmap for
mm-hmm,
that.
Mm-hmm.
It was process-oriented. It had to do with federalism within
yes.
the European Union.
Yes.
It did not assess in any comprehensive way U.S.
substantively,
privacy laws.
Yes, it was a procedural matter. I think this is very helpful, and I'm sure we will continue to work with the entire group, and this is an important issue. And, Mr. Chairman, I yield back at 17 seconds.
Gentleman yields back. The chair thanks the gentleman. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Vermont. Mr. Welch, 5 minutes for questions, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I thank the witnesses. Mr. Rothenberg, you mentioned that if we're the contours of legislation would have to address the 702 problem and provide FTC enforcement, correct? I want to ask you, Mr. Murphy, whether that would be problematic for you to allow the FTC to actually have the enforcement authority and to address the 702 problem.
I don't think we're in a position to assess that right now, but as a general rule, the business community has felt that the FTC does have extensive abilities to enforce U.S. privacy law as it exists. And we're constantly trying to educate our European colleagues about the misconceptions they have about the U.S. privacy regime.
Well, let me just interrupt a second, because this is really pretty critical. You've got, I think, general agreement here that we definitely want to have this safe harbor agreement extended. We want to be able to have this fluid flow of information back and forth, really for business reasons. There's a general agreement on privacy. But in order for there to be real enforcement, there has to be some mechanism to take action in the event there's a breach. That then gets us sometimes in this committee into a debate about the authority of, in this case, the FTC to act. There's a lot of folks, I think, who are pro-business who would be in favor of proper enforcement as long as it didn't go overboard. So I'm just looking for some indication from you as to the openness from your perspective as someone who'd be advocating for the business advantages of having that include a proper enforcement by a regulatory agency like the FTC.
It's something that I think calls for further investigation with our membership.
Okay. Ms. Espinel, let me ask you a few questions. Thank you very much, by the way. Just to recount the amount of business that goes back and forth, I mean, what's the implications for your industry in the event this problem is not solved?
So the implications are very significant. And you know, as it's not just the nearly 5,000 companies that have used the safe harbor. It is the millions of customers that rely on that. But there are all sorts of other implications as well. So, you know, for example, one of the things that we talk about in the area of cybersecurity is that you need information to follow the sun. You need cyber threat information to be in the hands of experts wherever they are awake around the world as quickly as possible. And things like this, the revocation of the safe harbor put that at risk. You know, there are all of the companies, many of the companies that rely on the safe harbor are using that in part to process payroll so that their employees back at home can be paid on time. The revocation of the safe harbor puts that at risk. I am confident that there are apps being developed in every district represented in this room. If those small companies, those small app developers want to extend into Europe, the revocation of the safe harbor puts that at risk. But more generally, the enormous business efficiency gains by both big companies and small companies from remote computing, from data analytics, cannot work unless data can move across borders. So the revocation of the safe harbor, one of the big risks there is that it takes all of that efficiency, all the enormous potential gains from that efficiency, and puts them at risk. And that affects every economic sector. That is not just the software industry. That is every economic sector in the world. I will just close by saying briefly, beyond the business effects, there are enormous societal benefits that are coming from things like data analytics, from forecasting cholera outbreaks to saving the lives of premature babies to helping farmers reduce use of pesticides. But it is a very new industry, and I think the shadow that the safe harbor decision cast over a nascent industry is potentially very damaging.
Okay, thank you. I only time for one more question, but thank you. I consider that a call to action, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Meltzer, the dispute here, how much of it has to do, in your view, with the revelations by Snowden, where, on the one hand, that raised questions about the privacy of information that was accessible to national security authorities here, but in Europe, we're being told that, in fact, the security agencies there do the same, but with less protections.
Certainly, the Snowden revelations have cast a significant pall over the entire political discourse in Europe around this issue. There is generally, you know, large mistrust in a number of member states about the way that the US government accesses personal data, and it's not well understood about the progress that has been made in the last couple of years to change that balance. So I think getting that right is certainly a big part of it. It's absolutely the case that this is a strange debate in Europe to the extent that the national security agencies are not part of the discussion here. And so the balance in the US between innovation, privacy, and that issue is being reflected very differently in Europe.
Okay, thank you. I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Chair thanks the gentleman. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Latta, the vice chairman of the Communications and Technology Subcommittee. 5 minutes for questions, please.
Well, thanks very much, Mr. Chairman. And again, to our witnesses, thanks very much for all of the information you've given us today. It's very enlightening. And, you know, because when we're talking about trade, it's important to all of us. I visit a lot of my businesses in my district all the time, and small businesses especially, it's amazing how many of them are telling me that they're looking at overseas to find more job creation for at home and then sell their products abroad. So this is very, very important to them to make sure that they can get their products out. And it's also making sure that they keep the people employed. If I could ask Mr. Murphy, again, we've been talking about this. I know the gentleman from New Jersey was also talking about a little bit ago that when the European Court, you said, did not examine the recent change in the U.S. oversight electronic surveillance, and you get into the essentially equivalent to the safeguards that exist in the EU. What do we have to do right now to get the Europeans convinced that we're going to have that essentially equivalent for our businesses to be able to work with them overseas right now?
Well, more than anything, I think we can do on this side of the pond, it's what we're seeing European business do, because if failure to achieve a new safe harbor agreement is bad for American business, it's far worse for Europe. According to ESIP, the European Center for International Political Economy, the think tank in Brussels, they conducted a study which found that complete data localization in Europe, which is obviously the worst possible outcome of the controversy today, would cost the European economy 1.3% of GDP. That's more than $200 billion. It would mean higher costs for European consumers as competition is lessened. Small businesses in Europe would be particularly hard hit, as I think we've discussed in a number of ways here. Some of the smaller EU member states would be particularly sidelined. You think about major service providers of digital services that are provided to companies and consumers. In many cases, they might simply overlook some of the smaller member states. We're often hearing from our European friends that they want to develop their own Silicon Valley. They lament that for some reason the U.S. economy is much more innovative. We have an ICT sector in this country that is growing and growing, and why can't they achieve it? Well, this kind of ruling could have a very chilling factor. And we should care about that, because Europe is our number one economic partner by far. And if they, if their economy, which is experiencing quite slow growth today, a failure to find a path forward here would be very costly for the American economy as well.
So thank you. Mr. Meltzer, if I could turn to you. And again, your testimony, and also what you've written in your testimony about that, when you look at the internet commerce in the United States, grew from at over $13 billion in 2011 to the estimate of about $133 billion in 2018. You know, we're seeing what's happening out there. But another question is, will the invalidation of the Safe Harbor Agreement indirectly impact trade relations and economies of countries that are outside the EU?
I think potentially, you know, absolutely it will be through a variety of mechanisms. One of them certainly is the fact that trade and commerce now happens in the context of global value chains. So a lot of the cross-border data between the US and the EU is in fact incorporating imports and products from around the world, certainly from our NAFTA partners, but more globally. And so the impacts and the flow through of reductions in transatlantic trade investment is going to have global implications. So that's at that level. More broadly is how this privacy debate, I think, plays out globally, whether in fact the world moves down an EU top-down privacy approach or adopts more of the US bottom-up company-led sectoral approach is going to, I think, have broader implications for the types of business models and trade flows that happen globally and will have significant implications for the US going forward.
Well, let me ask the follow-up on that then. What should the US government government are you doing right now to preempt the problems that could exist then for these countries outside the EU because of the decision?
I think one of the main efforts by the US government has been in the APEC context, the cross-border privacy principles there, which has been a set of principles around privacy, you know, really quite similar to the ones that the EU has. On the principle level, there's not that much disagreement. It's really about how they get applied and enforced, whether in fact businesses take responsibility for the privacy of the data, or ultimately it's going to be up to sort of a more regulatory government approach to make sure that that happens. Now, the differences cannot be so great even on that front, but that model, the APEC approach, is the one that the US has been trying to push through APEC and through other trade agreements and another forum.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. My time's expired and I yield back.
Chair, thanks. The gentleman yields back. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Illinois, the subcommittee chairman of the Environment and the Economy Subcommittee. 5 minutes for questions, please.
You forgot to say the powerful chairman of the Environment and the Economy. Welcome. We're glad to have you here. I'm going to be brief. I know my colleagues want to ask a few more questions, but and we've kind of beaten a dead horse. I just wanted to say, first of all, we need to get to a safe harder 2.0 as soon as possible. And we really can't move to data localization. It will hurt all these things on commerce, not just for big businesses, but individual consumers. If you look at banking transactions, or you're looking at obviously information, engineering data, going back and forth. I mean, it's just, I'm not sure that the public understands the enormity of this issue, and so we want the administration to keep moving forward positively in this realm. But I'm always curious about the court ruling and the European community not looking to their own backyard, and to the fact that I think the French new national security surveillance protocols are much more intrusive. And the proposed UK could be just as bad on the issues of privacy. So, Dr. Meltzer, can you talk about that a little bit? And are they more intrusive, and how they might differ?
I think we've seen in France, following the attacks, the Charlie Hebdo attacks and the attacks on the Jewish supermarket, that there has been proposals to reinvigorate and strengthen the way that the national security agencies operate in France, and certainly some of the proposals there would see collection of data and due process, which would be less than what you see in the US. I think the point is that each country has got to find its own appropriate balance between national security and privacy. The US is clearly going through a revision of that balance here following the Snowden leaks. The problem, I think, in the debate is that the way that discussion is playing out is that we have a separate debate on privacy as a human right when we talk about this between the US and the EU. And it ignores the security dimension to this, which is happening at the national member state level.
But they are member states of the EU, so it is curious for many of us to say it's okay for them locally with their own sovereignty or their own country, but as a member of the EU to place these additional barriers or concerns or disrupt trade when internally they may be as...
Mr. Schimpf?
Could be. I want to continue. I want one more question for Dr. Meltzer, and I did want to be brief. Can you talk about the Dr. Meltzer, back to the major part of the economy? What made any parts of the economy that would not be effective if this safe harbor ruling stays in place?
No, certainly I think this point has been made and is worth reinforcing, that this is a very much an economy issue. This is not a digital economy issue. This is not an IT economy issue. The advanced economies of the United States and Europe are increasingly digital in their entirety, whether we're talking about manufacturing sectors, services sectors, certainly the IT sector, the automobile sector, you name it. So there is no area that would not be affected by it.
Thank you, and I want to yield back my time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman yields back. Chair thanks the gentleman. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Kentucky, Mr. Guthrie, 5 minutes for questions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate y'all being here. I was just in a meeting with our NATO alliance members of Congress, parliaments from NATO alliance, and although we're talking about defense issues in our meetings, almost every time we were walking in or out or just coffee breaks, whatever, the European parliamentarians were very interested in talking about this issue. So it's it's important here, it's important there, and everybody's focused on us, or bring that up. But Ms. Espinola and Mr. Murphy, I have a few questions. You have member companies that are headquartered in the EU but have operations, subsidiaries, or other investment vehicles in the US? And if so, how has this decision impacted their business operations?
We do have members that are headquartered in the United States, and we also have members of significant operations in the United States. But I would say for our members, regardless of where they are headquartered, the risks are the same. Our members, regardless of where they are headquartered, and the customers that they serve need data to be moving back and forth across borders. So I think regardless of where the world that we live in today, regardless of where you're headquartered, I think the risk of the safe harbor revocation or the risk of a world in which data cannot move freely back and forth are the same.
Thank you. Mr. Murphy?
Just very briefly, we have many members that are U.S. affiliates of European multinationals, and they are just as concerned as the American companies. They see no upside in this. It doesn't provide some kind of a competitive advantage for them to have this kind of forced localization, which would be the worst possible outcome of a failure to renegotiate safe harbor. So there's common interest in securing a path forward here.
All right, so Mr. Murphy, I'll ask this to you. Then, so data localization proposals have been considered in a number of countries in the past few years. This topic was the focus of another meeting of this subcommittee. What has your experience been with the challenges these types of proposals pose to economies in today's global marketplace? Cross data flows have international implications, as you were just kind of elaborate what you were just saying, I guess.
Yes, and more than a dozen countries around the world, we've been active in trying to reach out to foreign governments to explain to them why data localization is not in their interest. As I mentioned earlier, there's nothing more common than receiving a head of state at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce who says, we want to create our own Silicon Valley. The idea of putting up protectionist walls that are going to somehow force the location of servers in the country or the use of domestic created technologies is really the worst possible prescription for them to be able to do that and do so in a globally competitive manner. So there have been victories in the past couple of years. For instance, the Brazilian government considered measures that they later rolled back after hearing from businesses around the world, and it's been quite a constructive relationship, but we continue to see these issues pop up in market after market.
Okay, thanks. And I have one more question for you, if Ms. Espinel would comment as well. So first, Mr. Murphy, how would you describe the FTC as an enforcement agency for the safe harbor? And how do FTC enforcement actions modify business behavior in the U.S.? And do you see any differences in the EU system that we should be aware of? And Ms. Espinel, if you'll comment after he comes.
Yeah. Well, the U.S. has one of the strongest systems of enforcement led by the FTC, and it has powers and penalties that are significantly stronger than its counterparts in the European Union, including 20-year consent decrees. We think that many of our friends in the European Union don't take that into account, and in particular, don't take into account how these laws are actually enforced. Whereas with some other countries that may replicate an EU member state law, they would accept their practices as somehow superior to those of the United States, even if enforcement is not nearly on the same level.
Thanks, Ms. Espo.
I would just say, you know, I think at a fundamental level, the systems and certainly the focus on privacy between the United States and Europe are not that different. But one of the things that is different about our system is the enforcement authority, the FTC, and I would say on behalf of the software sector, we have seen the FTC increasing its enforcement authority and using it in ways, and we think that those are positive steps. We do think, as has been alluded to earlier today, that there may not be a full understanding on the other side of the Atlantic of the improvements that have been made in our privacy system, including FTC enforcement. And I think that's something we need to collectively try to address. But to your basic question, we are supportive of FTC enforcement, and we have been seeing more of that over recent years, and we think that is a good development.
Thank you, and I yield back the balance of my time. Appreciate the question.
The gentleman yields back, Chair. Thanks, gentlemen. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Mississippi. Mr. Harper, 5 minutes for questions, please.
Do you need to say Mississippi again, Mr. Chairman? Did you get that? Thank you. And thanks to each of you for being here today. This is a critically important topic, and to discuss this is very important. And Ms. Espinel, if I could ask you first, can you explain how the United States can make the case that we offer essential equivalence in terms of data protection currently?
So, as I was saying, I think I would say a couple of things. You know, I think in terms of, as we said before, our immediate goal is to try to get a new safe harbor. And I think that is a step that the European Commission can take if they choose to do so, and we are optimistic that they will choose to do so. But I think looking at the long term, essential equivalence or the appropriate standing for privacy protection, that is something that is going to continue to evolve, at least that is our opinion, as laws and practices change around the world. And so what we need for the long term is we need a system that is flexible enough. We believe we need a system that is based on principles as opposed to prescriptive regulations. And we need a system that recognizes the importance of privacy. And again, I don't think the differences there between the United States and Europe are that great, but also creates a framework so that a person's personal data will attract the same level of protection as it moves around the world. I think that is something that is important to the United States as well as Europe. And we need to be able to find the right balance. We need to let law enforcement do the job that it has to do. And you will not be surprised to hear, on behalf of the business community, large and small, we need to have a system that will reduce the legal uncertainty of the situation that we face today.
Okay. And of course, the challenge for us is to make sure that the rules and regulations don't get in the way of the technology that seems to move at a much faster pace on occasion. So it is a challenge for all of us to go there. Mr. Murphy, if I could ask you, and I know you're following up on what's been discussed, what you've mentioned, the ECJ ruling puts some European businesses who transfer data to American companies at risk as well. Could you discuss further whether European businesses have any incentive to put pressure on the U.S. and the Commission to come to an agreement on the safe harbor, and if so, how?
Well, thank you for that question. The many of our sister associations on the other side of the Atlantic are hard at work reaching out to the European Commission and to member state governments, urging them to find a path forward as well. If there's one thing that businesses of all size dislike, it's uncertainty. And the reach of the ruling that came out in early October was significantly further than anything that was anticipated. And the absence of any kind of a clear transition plan, guidance to companies on how they should behave in the interim while potentially this new safe harbor agreement is concluded, has caused real concern across companies in Europe as well. So we've encouraged them to make their voices heard in Europe as we're doing here.
Thank you, Mr. Murphy. With that, I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman yields back. The chair thanks the gentleman. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Olson. 5 minutes for questions, please.
I thank the chair and welcome to all four witnesses. In many ways, Europe is following Rahm Emanuel's, President Obama's first chief of staff lead. He said, "You never want a serious crisis to go to waste." End quote. The difference is, this is not a serious crisis. It's a problem. Again, it's not a serious crisis. It's a problem that will be a crisis unless we fix it by January 31st of next year. Mr. Murphy, Ms. Clark brought up the BCRs, the binding corporate rules, also the model contract clauses. Companies have those in effect right now. How are they impacted by the ECJ decision with their data? How they impacted the model contract clauses and the binding corporate rules, companies have those. Their data, how's that impacted by the European Council, the ECJ's ruling?
Well, these mechanisms were not invalidated by the ruling. However, they're practically out of reach for so many different companies. And as was mentioned earlier, the expense of $1 million and the time it takes 18 months to negotiate a new one has made them really impractical for many companies to consider this as an alternative. And you might think that in the wake of this ruling that many companies are considering whether and how they can enter into more of these. And it appears that in the case of some large companies, they are definitely examining some of these alternatives going forward. But for the smaller companies, it simply isn't tenable.
Ms. Espino, care to comment on the issue, the BCRs, the MCCs, with your clients, your members?
So many of our members are looking at various mechanisms to address this, but I would echo what Mr. Murphy said, despite the fact that the European Court of Justice opinion does not speak directly to things like the model contract clauses, they are first out of reach for many, many businesses around the world. And second, to us, they do not represent sort of long-term solution that we need to have. And that's why we continue to focus on the fact that while we think it is immediate and vital to have a new safe harbor in place and then have some time for companies to come into compliance with that, we need to have a long-term solution that moves beyond things like model contract clauses so that we are not, we do not find ourselves in this situation again a year or two down the road.
One final question for our witnesses. The ECJ's decision may open up liability for data transfers from Europe to America for the entire period of the 15 years of safe harbor. A Bloomberg article says this works may be exposed to liability. My question is that real, Ms. Espinel? Is that a real issue out there? Can 15 years be thrown away with this court decision? Exposed liability, American companies, European companies?
I think there is a real risk there. However, I would echo what you said. I think what we are facing right now is a significant problem, not a crisis. And I say that in part because we are confident that the United States and Europe will be able to come to a sensible resolution and conclude a safe harbor and avoid that situation.
Mr. Dr. Meltzer, your comment, sir? Good idea.
Let me just say briefly on your question about BCR and contracts. I agree with what my panelists have said. It's worth noting that data protection authorities in Germany have specifically said that they do not think that BCRs and contracts are legally viable mechanisms any longer. The concern, obviously, is that the structural problems that the European Court of Justice has found with the privacy regime here in the United States is broadly applicable to contracts and BCRs as well. So the issues there make these other mechanisms also unstable.
Thank you. Mr. Robert, the question about liability thrown out for 15 years.
Yes, Mr. Olson, I don't think there would be retroactive application of the safe harbor decision for prior data transfers. So the short answer is I don't think that risk exists. However, I think there is another risk to be aware of, which is that this January 2016 deadline that people are talking in terms of presumes that the Article 29 Working Party can keep all of the data protection officials in Europe in check. And all of those national officials have independent authority. So it's actually possible that at any time over the next few months, there could be an enforcement action after the Schrems decision became final.
Mr. Murphy, data for the last 15 years of our safe harbor, some sort of liability for those?
I don't have an answer for you, but certainly this is precisely the sort of uncertainty that alarms corporate counsel and companies across the country.
I thank the witnesses. I ask unanimous consent to enter the article for Bloomberg in the record. My chairman, I yield back.
Without objection, so ordered. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Kansas, Mr. Mateo. Thank you for your forbearance and recognize for 5 minutes for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to try and clear away some of what I think are the underlying facts. We've talked a lot about policy. I want to make sure we've got, as best I can, some basic facts in place. Ms. Espinel, maybe we'll start with you. Your company's data, if the data belongs to a U.S. person or a non-U.S. person, do your companies treat that data any differently?
Our companies put the highest level of protection and security on all of their customers' data, regardless of the nationality.
Right, so they treat it identically. Mr. Murphy, same for yours. Doesn't matter whether a U.S. person or not, the data is treated identically.
Absolutely.
Same protections. I've heard, we could go look at the record, I've heard the word privacy concerns uttered maybe 50 times this morning. Concerns are one thing. Ms. Espinel, is there any evidence of abusive practices from U.S. companies with respect to handling PII of either U.S. persons or non-U.S. persons? We had data breaches, we have data get out, I get that. But yes, to you.
So I will speak on behalf of my members. Our members are not abusing the data of their customers.
Right, they're doing their best to protect it. Mr. Murphy, I assume yours are as well.
That is certainly my impression, and the potential reputational damage from failure to do so is, I think, a powerful factor in their consideration.
I completely agree. Let me talk about reputational damage, actually. Mr. Rothenberg, in his testimony, in his written testimony, in the summary, said, quote, "Transatlantic data transfers without legal protections were never safe." Mr. Murphy, do you think that's true? Do you think these data transfers have been performed in an unsafe manner?
No, I think that it's been a 15-year record of success and really comparable in success to that related to data transfers within Europe between member states.
Ms. Espinel, would you agree with that?
Speaking for the members that I represent, yes, I would agree with that.
I think it's that kind of hyperbole that has caused the European elected officials to have no backbone on this issue. I get the politics, I get the protectionism. I completely understand how they've all watched the Snowden hearings and decided they could get elected, but didn't defend the privacy actions that are taken by your companies. We've had talk today about Section 702. Mr. Murphy, do any of your clients ever collect data under Section 702?
I'm just, I just have no information on that.
Yeah. Ms. Espinel, do you know?
I don't, but what I would say is that we've made this point at the hearing before. I think one of the things that is crucial here is there is a real lack of understanding on both sides of the Atlantic, but I think the Europeans, both on our privacy regimes, but also as what's touched on earlier, the complications of our various surveillance regimes. And one thing that I don't think has been done, but I think would be very useful, is to have a comprehensive analysis of the surveillance regimes across the European Union states, because I don't think there is a good and clear understanding, and I think that has led to a lot of confusion, you know, deliberate or not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's not lack of understanding. I think it's willful ignorance, but maybe we disagree. Mr. Rothenberg, I want to make sure I understood something you said. You talked about Section 702 a bit. I know a little bit about it, but maybe you know more. Is it your position that U.S. persons and non-U.S. persons should be treated identically with respect to the government U.S. government collection of information?
I think under the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, there's a clear distinction.
No, I'm asking if you think, if you've suggested a modification to U.S. law, that's U.S. law. I guess my question is it your position or organization's position that U.S. persons and non-U.S. persons should be treated identically with respect to government information collection?
As a general matter, yes. And most of U.S. privacy law takes that position, particularly on the commercial side. There's no distinction in our commercial privacy law. Yeah. Between U.S. persons and non-U.S. persons.
Fair enough. Just so you know, that'd be ahistoric. Just, you could well be right about it being proper, but no nation has ever behaved that way with the collection of data for their own citizens as against the others. There's always a wrinkle. There's always an exception. There's always a Section 1233 executive order. There's always a way the nations have, in their efforts to provide national security for their own people, have behaved that way. And I actually think the United States does a remarkable job of protecting citizens all around the world and protecting their data in their efforts to keep us all safe.
Sir, I think that's important. Do you think that the Office of Personnel and Management has done an excellent job protecting the records of federal employees?
Oh, no, sir. There's errors all along the way. I'm asking about
21.5 million records.
I'm asking about policy and
SF-86. Those are the background investigations.
Very familiar with that. I filled one out. I think mine was released as well, sir. So I'm infinitely familiar with that. I didn't say we didn't have errors and mistakes. I'm simply talking about policy. Let me ask one more question. Is there any way, Mr. Murphy, you talked about this $1 million cost for private solutions, this BCRs or other delegated methodology. Is there any way to drive that cost down? Is there any way to make that $100,000 cost instead of $1 million cost?
Not substantially. And I think that as we look at some of these alternatives like BCRs, to the degree that they do continue to be relevant going forward, it's a field day for lawyers, and I suppose there's some job creation in that, but that's clearly not the intention of the policy.
Thank you. I'm past my time. Thank you for bearing with me, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Chair, thanks, gentlemen. Gentleman yields back. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Bilirakis. 5 minutes for your questions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the panel for testifying. This issue arose quickly, and I'm glad we are addressing it today so that some certainty can be given to the numerous businesses seeking answers as they try to continue the pursuits in the global marketplace. Mr. Espinel and Mr. Murphy, I know you touched on this a bit, but what challenges are companies facing as they evaluate and even implement the other mechanisms in the EU that permit data transfers to countries outside the EU?
So one specific challenge that companies are facing, big companies and small companies, is the processing of their payroll and making sure that their employees could get on time. If there's not a resolution of the safe harbor, that is something that could be at risk, and that is obvious business disruption, but is also disruption to the lives of human beings that are employed by those companies. Let me mention one thing that I haven't mentioned before. We did a survey last year, which I would be happy to share, where we talked to the CEOs and senior executives of companies in the United States and Europe in terms of what data meant to them and how valuable it was to their business. And one of the things that was really surprising to me is if you, really small companies, companies that have less than 50 employees, already today find data enormously important to going into new markets, serving their customers, developing new products. What I found less surprising is that is true on both sides of the Atlantic. So for U.S. companies and for European companies, the ability to move data back and forth in order to do business is critically important.
Thank you, Ms. Espinel. Mr. Murphy?
Well, little to add, but I would just to recapitulate one point. The morning the ruling came out, I think many of us were just disappointed at the lack of any guidance that came out from the European Commission. And there's been a little bit more since then, but that is exactly the kind of uncertainty that is serves as a wet blanket on the economy at a time when not only is the U.S. economy not growing as rapidly as we would like, but in Europe, far worse. And it's the last thing that the global economy overall needs right now.
Well, thanks so much. Another question for you, Mr. Murphy. What impact does the European Court of Justice ruling have on the negotiations of other large-scale international trade agreements like the TPP and the TTIP?
So the United States and the European Union are 2 years into negotiating a comprehensive transatlantic trade and investment partnership agreement. These negotiations are still at a relatively early stage, despite the length of time involved. This kind of a ruling, though, it does certainly put a damper on the mood in the room. After all, the TTIP, as that negotiation is called, is intended to safeguard the not just the movement of goods and services across international borders, but also data as a trade issue. U.S. trade agreements, including the TPP, have strong measures to prohibit the forced localization of data. And of course, privacy regimes coexist with those trade obligations, and privacy obligations are not undermined by the trade agreements. But the situation we have right now with the invalidation of the Safe Harbor Agreement certainly has led some to question the seriousness with which we can move forward in those negotiations.
So there are some national security concerns until the Safe Harbor Agreement is signed.
Well, certainly for commercial data and the ability to move it across border, that's that is very much a concern.
Thank you. Dr. Meltzer, what impact has the global reach of the internet had on small and medium-sized businesses? You mentioned in your testimony that they are underrepresented in international trade. Is this just a function of their size, or can we incentivize small and medium-sized businesses in international trade agreements going forward?
Traditionally, SMEs have not been big players in the international economic landscape. It's been for a variety of reasons to do with cost and capacity. The internet has certainly changed that for them. The International Trade Commission did an interesting study which found that access to information, for instance, about overseas markets has been one of the key barriers for small and medium-sized enterprises in just thinking about going global. That cost of getting that information is obviously now close to zero. It's just one example of the many ways that internet and internet platforms are now providing new opportunities for SMEs to be part of the global economy.
Thank you. I yield back, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate it.
Gentleman yields back. The chair thanks the gentleman. Chair recognizes the gentlelady from Indiana, Ms. Brooks. 5 minutes for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My home state of Indiana has a large contingent of pharmaceutical and device companies who depend on the Safe Harbor to transfer, and I believe we've talked about the issues of big data and those companies that are using big data. Companies like Eli Lilly use the cloud-based software for the users can share medical images with other departments and centers and countries around the world to improve the product design, to allow for nearly instantaneous interpretation and diagnosis of medical records, and compile records for clinical studies. And we certainly know that the utilization of cross-border data enables all of our life sciences companies in the country to use these data sets so we can get treatments and that we can improve faster development of treatments and diagnoses and better healthcare for not just those in the U.S., but for the world. And so I certainly recognize the anxiety everyone is having at this point in time based on the ECJ decision. But I'm curious, what do you think we should be watching in this next few months as this January 2016 deadline is approaching? What should we be watching? And what there's been dialogue about this with our government and with EU members for years now. I actually participated in one of those discussions in late 2013. in Brussels with some other members of Congress, a bipartisan delegation, but yet it does not seem as if we have bridged the gap of either trust or of understanding, and I'm curious what you all believe we need to be doing a better job of doing to either get to a Safe Harbor Agreement 2.0, and my second question is, why do we believe that the court will even agree, or why do we believe it would even be upheld and not challenged immediately again? And I guess I'd like to hear each of your comments. Ms. Espinal?
So in the short term, as you say, I think we need to focus on concluding the safe harbor. It is the kind of discussion that you were having with your European counterparts, I think, is really important. I think having hearings like this that focus on the issue is really important. I think if we're going to be able to make progress, both in terms of concluding in the short term the negotiations and the longer term solution, we need to have a constructive political environment. And part of the way that we get there is by having Congress in contact, not just with the administration, but also with your European counterparts, both to help them understand our privacy system better and understand the improvements that have been made in that privacy system. I think that is a really important role that Congress can play, both in the short term and over the longer term.
So I attended with the chair of House Intelligence Committee, Chairman Rogers, and the ranking member Rupesberger in this delegation meeting. What are you familiar with other conversations? That was in 2013. And are you familiar with other conversations that members of Congress have had, or that because it's clear to me that what the negotiations and the discussions between the administration officials, it's not working.
Right.
So where are we falling down?
Let me begin by saying I actually think Congressman Sensenbrenner deserves a lot of recognition for the work that he has done on this issue. I think it's one more demonstration of how privacy really does cross the aisle. And I know he has expressed concern about making changes to 702, and that's one of the issues that we think does need to be addressed. But I think it's also important in the context of this hearing to understand that there's a difference between the political negotiation that takes place between the U.S. Commerce Department and the European Commission and a judicial decision from the top court in Europe. I mean, this really is a game changer, and it impacts what even the European Commission can do in its negotiation with the United States. So to your question, I think it will be very interesting to see over the next few months how this change in European Union law, which is what's happened, will influence the privacy officials across Europe. They may decide to take enforcement actions.
Mr. Murphy?
I think one of the most important things that members of Congress can do is to educate their European counterparts on the importance of these data flows. And coming back to your example about medical devices, just yesterday we were hearing from one of our member companies that manufactures medical devices, and some of these, such as different scanners, CAT scanners, PET scanners, MRIs, are very large, expensive, sophisticated pieces of equipment. In some smaller EU member states, there may be only a very small handful of them around. And they are often maintained and used remotely. Right. That's another example of the kind of data which needs to flow. And you know, talk about taking the whole debate to a very personal level, that the ability to get this kind of medical information, the idea that it could be impeded by a failure to arrive at a new safe harbor agreement is something that I think all of us find concerning.
Thank you. I yield back.
Gentlelady yields back to the chair. Thanks, the gentlelady. The chair would just ask, are there any other members seeking time for questions? Seeing none, I do want to thank our witnesses for being here today. Before we conclude, I would like to submit the following documents for the record by unanimous consent. A statement from the International Trade Administration at the United States Department of Commerce, a letter from the Direct Marketing Association, a statement from the Information Technology and Innovation Foundation, a statement from the American Action Forum, a joint letter from the Auto Alliance, American Automotive Policy Council, and global automakers, and a list of all of the 4,400 United States companies who are active beneficiaries of the Safe Harbor Agreement. I will not read them unless asked. pursuant to committee rules, I remind members they have 10 business days to submit additional questions for the record. I ask the witnesses to submit their responses within 10 business days of the receipt of those questions. Without objection, the subcommittee stands adjourned.
Back to you.